Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled American Inquisition, the Era of McCarthyism. Your professor is Ellen Schrecker, professor of history at Yeshiva University in New York City. Professor Schrecker earned her B.A. and M.A. from Radcliffe College and her Ph.D. from Harvard University. She has held teaching posts at many prestigious universities, including Princeton, NYU, and Harvard. A child of the 1950s, Dr. Schrecker developed an early interest in McCarthyism after her sixth-grade teacher became a victim of the Red Scare. She later created a course on the subject and discovered that there was a lack of books available that would help her students to fully comprehend the era. Since that time, she has published widely on the subject, including works entitled Many Are the Crimes, McCarthyism in America, which was selected as a Choice Outstanding Book in 1998. The Age of McCarthyism, A Brief History with Documents, and No Ivory Tower, McCarthyism and the Universities, which was awarded the History of Education Society's Outstanding Book Award in 1987. Today, Dr. Schrecker is widely recognized as one of the nation's leading authorities on the McCarthy era, and frequently appears in the national media to discuss the subject. The rights of freedom of speech and freedom of association guaranteed by the Constitution are often considered the building blocks of a democratic society. Many, therefore, take these basic freedoms for granted and do not imagine that they could ever be challenged. But at certain points in our nation's history, even these fundamental rights have come under fire. For example, the Sedition Act of World War I limited the rights of citizens to publish and distribute materials considered subversive to the war effort. Likewise, many claim that the Patriot Act, enacted by Congress following the terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001, serves to unjustly curtail civil liberties. In this course, we'll examine perhaps the most notorious example of political repression in the United States, the era of McCarthyism. Called by many the longest-lasting and most widespread episode of political repression in American history, the period saw dozens of men and women imprisoned, thousands lose their jobs, and countless others silenced by the fear of such consequences. As we explore the events and significant figures of the McCarthy era, we'll examine how the ambitious crusade of a young senator from Wisconsin became one of the greatest challenges to the principles of an open society. We'll assess the costs of McCarthyism not only in terms of the men and women directly involved with it, but more significantly, how it has affected American culture, politics, and society. In the end, we'll discover how the subject of McCarthyism remains relevant to this very day, and, if nothing else, serves to remind us that we cannot and should not ever take our basic freedoms for granted. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin American Inquisition, the Era of McCarthyism, Lecture 1. Junius Scales and My Sixth Grade Teacher. Two stories of the McCarthy era and what they tell us about political repression in Cold War America. And now, Professor Schrecker.
Welcome to our course on McCarthyism, political repression in Cold War America. Over the next 14 lectures, we're going to be looking at McCarthyism, at what was arguably the longest lasting and most widespread episode of political repression in American history. I'd like to begin by looking at two rather representative cases that I hope will introduce some of the main themes that we're going to be looking at in this course. The first case is that of a man named Junius Scales. Junius Scales was a rather mild-mannered, fairly well-known North Carolinian figure. He came from a good Southern family. But he was fairly well known because he was the most public member of the North Carolina Communist Party. In October 1961, the Supreme Court decided in a split 5-4 decision that Junius Scales would have to go to prison. His crime? He had been convicted of being a member of the Communist Party. And that, according to a 1940 law known as the Smith Act, meant that he was a member of an organization that taught and advocated the violent overthrow of the United States. Now, Junius Scales was a rather mild-mannered man, no threat whatsoever to the American government, but in 1961, he went to prison. What does this show us about McCarthyism? It shows us, among other things, that McCarthyism had a much longer life than Senator Joseph McCarthy's political career. After all, McCarthy had died in 1957, 4 years before Junius Scales went to prison. It shows us that McCarthyism did not affect mainly innocent liberals, people who were not political, who had been randomly harassed by one or another of the mechanisms of the politically repressive machine. Rather, it shows us that McCarthyism affected people who were like Junius Scales in or near the American Communist Party. And this is a very important element of McCarthyism that we're going to be looking at throughout the rest of this audio course. I'd like to look now at our second representative case, that of my sixth grade teacher, Mr. C. And what's interesting is you'll notice I'm not giving you his regular name. His brush with McCarthyism was secret, and we're keeping it a secret to protect him and his family. Throughout the McCarthy period, one of the most important elements of this political repression was that it was secret, that the victims and the victimizers tended to keep things under the rug, didn't talk about it in public, in part because it would have affected people's careers, people's chances for getting jobs. In any event, what happened to my sixth grade teacher was simply that one day in the middle of the school year of 1953, he lost his job. He was fired. There was no explanation. Nobody at the school explained why Mr. C had left. He had not been called before a congressional committee, although often we tend to view the McCarthy phenomenon as something that is identified with the congressional committees like the House Un-American Activities Committee or HUAC or McCarthy's own committee. But much of what we would call McCarthyism occurred without having a committee intervening. My own assumption about Mr. C's firing was that it was probably the result of an intervention by the FBI, that an FBI agent had somehow gotten in touch with the authorities at Temple University, which was running the school that we went to during that period, and that they had slipped a memorandum about Mr. C's previous political activities to the authorities, and that had resulted in his dismissal. What does this show us about McCarthyism? Again, quite a lot. It shows us how the economic sanctions that were absolutely crucial to the McCarthy era operated. It shows us as well something about the blanket of secrecy that concealed so much of what went on. We know about the people who, like the Hollywood Ten, whose cases were in the newspapers, who had very public trials like Julius Rosenberg. But in many respects, these are the tip of the iceberg. A lot of what happened during the McCarthy period. A lot of the political repression took the form of quiet dismissals of people like my sixth grade teacher. Another aspect of this case was that Mr. C had once been a communist. I don't know if he was still in the party at the time he was fired or not. Many people who had been in the party had long since left it by the mid-1950s. But Mr. C had once been a communist. He had even been very active in a left-wing labor union in another city. And the FBI probably knew that and probably informed the authorities at Temple University about him. Now, I'd like to go back and take these two cases and look a little more at what they do show us about that anti-communist furor of the early Cold War period we call McCarthyism. Obviously, as the case of Junius Scales shows us, time-wise, in terms of chronology, McCarthyism was much more than McCarthy's career. It began, as we will discover when we look at some of the antecedents of the McCarthy era, it's something that we can trace those antecedents all the way back to the late 19th century, certainly all the way back to the Red Scare of the 1920s that we'll be looking at in a few lectures. Certainly back to the political unrest and labor union organizing of the 1930s that we'll be looking at in a future lecture. And it extended, as Junius Scales' case shows us, long after Joseph McCarthy was put in his grave. Another aspect of the McCarthy period that I think these cases show us is its very close connection to the Communist Party. During the 1950s, it was often common for people who were upset about McCarthyism and upset about McCarthy to talk as if this was a kind of random terror that struck ordinary people in every walk of life in the United States. That was not the case. It was very focused and mainly affected people who were in or near the Communist Party. Altogether, we have a body count. And again, remember that this is not an exact body count because of this enormous secrecy. But we do know that at least two people were killed, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg. Several hundred were sent to prison or deported, and probably, and here the figures are very hard to come by, probably maybe 10 to 12,000 people lost their jobs in one way or another because of this political repression. Now, compared to the kind of political repression that we see in totalitarian regimes, that we saw in Stalin's Russia or Hitler's Third Reich, certainly this is not a dreadful and horrendous form of political repression. But I think it's important to argue that it was very effective in squelching certain kinds of political dissent. And during the course of future lectures, we're going to be looking at the impact of this political repression on political dissent in the United States and in the way in which these primarily economic sanctions operated in keeping people from questioning the course of the Cold War, in keeping people from speaking out on unpopular topics, speaking out in ways that would have made them controversial politically, and in ways that they feared might cost them their jobs or their livelihood in some way. One of the other things that we're going to be looking at as we study McCarthyism in much more detail over the next few lectures, is the way in which it operated. One of the reasons why it was so effective was simply that it was a very multi-stranded form of political repression. It didn't operate out of one institution, but out of many. The FBI, congressional committees, local committees, local district attorneys, movie studios, universities, many, many institutions were involved here. And I think that multi-stranded nature of McCarthyism is one of the reasons why it was so effective. Another of the characteristics of this kind of political repression, and one of the reasons, again, why it was so effective, was that on the whole, McCarthyism operated as a two-stage process. The first process, which I call that of identification, was one in which individuals or organizations were branded as being somehow affected with communism, branded as being communist groups, communist individuals, whatever. And that identification stage was usually handled by an arm of the federal government, the FBI, slipping a dossier to the authorities at Temple University that fired my sixth grade teacher, or a congressional investigating committee calling up somebody who would then take the Fifth Amendment, or perhaps a journalist writing a column that identified somebody as belonging to the Communist Party. That was that first stage of identification. And it was often viewed as constituting McCarthyism as a whole. However, there was a second stage, the stage of applying sanctions. That was done by employers who followed up on that first identification stage by applying economic sanctions against the men or women who were identified by a congressional committee or the FBI. What that two-stage process did was enable many of the people who applied these second stage economic sanctions to distance themselves from McCarthyism. McCarthyism, they claimed, was what the committees were doing. What they were doing was something else. Maybe it was protecting their institution. Maybe it was simply a kind of house cleaning that they felt they needed to do. But it wasn't McCarthyism. And that separability, I think, made it possible for many otherwise liberal, otherwise civil libertarian, often, people to claim that they oppose McCarthyism when, in fact, as we shall see over the course of the next few lectures, they were really collaborating with it and making it function in a way that enabled our democratic society to engage in a very effective form of political repression. Another thing that I'd like to look at today as we begin our survey of what McCarthyism was is the kinds of explanations that have previously been given for this particular phenomenon. These explanations have changed over time, often in response to the sort of changing political climate in the broader society as well as within the historical profession. The first interpretation of McCarthyism, or at least the first one that really gained a lot of attention, occurred at the time that McCarthyism was at its peak in the mid-1950s. This interpretation has often been identified with a group of utterly brilliant historians and sociologists, the most important of them, Richard Hofstadter, a famous and very brilliant historian, and Daniel Bell, a sociologist who in 1955 edited a very crucial set of essays by this group of historians and sociologists called, I think, the Radical Right. In their essays, Hofstadter Bell and Seymour Martin Lipset, another very important sociologist, tended to take McCarthy himself at face value and to focus on the kind of populist language that he was using, the kinds of attacks that he was making on the Eastern elite upper class establishment, people like the Secretary of State, Dean Acheson, who was one of McCarthy's favorite targets and whom McCarthy always talked about as having been, quote unquote, born with a silver spoon in his mouth. And they viewed McCarthyism, therefore, as a kind of populist, lower-class phenomenon directed against the Eastern establishment. As we will see later, this particular interpretation is rather wide of the mark, but it was very widely accepted in the mid-1950s. Hofstadter and Bell also identified the protagonists of McCarthyism, the people who supported it, as people who were very concerned with their status, who were overwhelmed by a kind of status anxiety. And they identified two particular groups. One were white upper class Anglo-Saxon WASPs, the traditional rulers of American society, who were seeing their traditional position of power slipping away as second generation Americans, ethnic Americans, began to gain more and more political and economic power. And these people manifested their concern with their declining status by supporting McCarthyism. The other group that Hofstadter, Bell, and Lipset identified as manifesting this status anxiety were upwardly mobile ethnic people who wanted to display their quote-unquote Americanism by climbing onto the McCarthyism bandwagon. There are a lot of problems with this interpretation of McCarthyism as status anxiety. Among other things, it encompasses just about everybody in American society. It also has the problem that there is apparently no empirical evidence supporting it whatsoever. And historians became somewhat disillusioned with this particular type of interpretation, which, though brilliant and persuasive on the surface, really had very little evidence to back it up. By the mid-1960s, historians began to take a second look at the McCarthy phenomenon, and they began to see it no longer as some kind of aberration, no longer as some kind of psychological manifestation of American anxieties, but rather as normal, ordinary partisan politics. In particular, they viewed McCarthy himself as an ordinary Republican politician who, admittedly a little more raucous, admittedly a little more reckless, nonetheless was following a scenario that many other Republican politicians were also pushing. And McCarthyism was, in fact, a program that many conservative Republicans had been adopting since the late 1930s as a way to damage the New Deal administration. Many of these historians in the 1960s also viewed McCarthyism as emanating from the Truman administration's campaign to gain support for its Cold War foreign policy and to gain support by exaggerating the dangers of communism, both overseas and especially at home. As we shall see during the course of our future lectures, this Truman administration desire to sort of hype anti-communism turned out to backfire against the Truman administration itself. But perhaps, as we can see, Harry Truman wasn't aware of that in the beginning. A further revision of our view of what McCarthyism meant developed in the 1970s, partly as a result of the Watergate scandals of the Nixon administration. When we began to get records from the FBI, when we began to discover that J. Edgar Hoover had had his hand in a lot of dirty tricks, many of which inflated the quote-unquote communist menace, many of which, as we are going to see in future lectures, helped inflate the role of the FBI itself in determining the nature of McCarthyism. And by the late 1970s, it became very clear that it was no longer possible to look at this sort of widespread anti-communist furor without going deeply into FBI records, without taking account of the truly central role here of J. Edgar Hoover and his agents. More recently, however, historians have, in a funny way, returned to some of the earlier explanations, not in terms of the populism or status anxiety that somebody like Richard Hofstadter was looking at, but rather by taking into account a more cultural explanation of what was going on. A cultural history has become very popular within the historical profession. We're beginning to look much more at sort of a kind of mentality as determining what kinds of things manifested themselves within the American political sphere. And this cultural interpretation has come to be sort of added on as an extra layer to some of our earlier views of McCarthyism. The most persuasive of these new interpretations is that of the late Berkeley political scientist Michael Paul Rogan, who talks about the counter-subversive tradition in American politics. And by that, he's talking about a very old tradition that tends to seek, especially during times of stress, it's a tradition that tends to seek the cause of troubles within American politics as coming from some kind of alien body within American society, some kind of alien, quote-unquote, other that gets demonized, that gets focused on, and that somehow is subverting our good American tradition through whatever, terrorism perhaps in the 19th century, it was Catholics. In the early 20th century, it was various forms of radicals. And during the McCarthy period, of course, it was communists. But what Rogan has focused on, and I think what is very important to look at and to keep in our mind as we continue looking at some of the other elements of McCarthyism, is the psychological attraction of this notion that there's somehow an alien body within American society that is the cause of presumably the troubles that our society is facing. The final layer of interpretation that we want to add to our understanding of the meaning of McCarthyism has occurred very recently, since 1995, when the federal government released the transcripts of some declassified, decrypted, intercepted KGB telegrams that revealed Soviet espionage within the American government during World War II. These documents, and they're known by the totally meaningless code name of the Venona transcripts, decrypts, had been deciphered during the late 1940s, 1950s, but they were highly secret, and they've only recently been released to a wider public, as well as documents that have become known since the fall of the Soviet Union, and documents that, like the Venona decrypts, have shown the kind of Soviet espionage that was taking place in this country. So that these new documents require us to rethink our approach to the whole question of Soviet espionage, which was such a key element in sort of gearing up popular anxiety and government repression in this country. And we'll be looking in considerable detail at what the Venona decrypts have shown us. Finally, we need to look, I think, at why McCarthyism was so controversial and why McCarthyism remains so controversial. Here, I think there are a number of issues involved. One is that it's simply a episode that is of enormous human interest. Ordinary people were facing a kind of moral dilemma sometimes when they were called before committees. And this has engaged playwrights. It's engaged novelists. It engages television, docudrama creators, because the human interest issues here are so central. You know, should we squeal? Should people keep things secret? A whole bunch of really central issues. But there are other reasons, I think, why McCarthyism is so crucial here. To begin with, it questions American behavior during the Cold War. After the fall of the Soviet Union, there was, in many treatments of the Cold War, a kind of moral triumphalism, a sense that the United States, quote unquote, won the Cold War because we were a better society. But McCarthyism clearly was not American democracy's final hour, and it requires us to take a more nuanced view of what was going on during the Cold War. Finally, of course, at this particular moment, there is an enormous relevance to the whole question of civil liberties and national security, and it's an issue that we will be talking about certainly at the end of our audio course. Before I end this first lecture, I'd like to give you a quick overview of some of the main themes that we'll be dealing with over the course of the next 13 lectures. We'll begin by looking at our witches and witch hunters. We're going to be looking first at the Communist Party, important because that was where most of the victims came from. And it's important to understand its history and why communism was so vulnerable to repression in this country. We will also look in considerable detail at the way in which the mechanisms of McCarthyism operated. We'll look at some of the most important agencies involved. Certainly, we're going to take an entire lecture to examine the FBI, what I consider the single most important institution of McCarthyism and the core of this anti-communist network. We're also going to be looking at the congressional committees, not just that committee chaired by Joseph McCarthy, but HUAC and some of the other committees that were equally important. We'll be looking as well at the federal government's loyalty security program, a program that was designed in 1947 and that became a template for many similar programs within both the public and private sphere. We'll be looking as well at the way in which private employers enforced economic sanctions, at the way in which the federal courts legitimized the political repression that took place, at the way in which many liberal institutions, in a sense, went along with the blacklist, or else simply didn't oppose it. In a way, we'll be looking I look at these as the kind of good Germans of the McCarthy era, the people and institutions that might have stopped or mitigated this repression, but didn't. Finally, we'll look at the impact of McCarthyism on our cultural and political life. We'll look at some of the areas from Hollywood to Harvard, to the labor movement, to the civil rights movement that were most affected by the Cold War Red Scare. And we'll try to draw some lessons from that impact for today. Can it happen again? And how can we prevent it? We'll look at all these things over the next 13 lectures. And in our next lecture, we'll begin by looking at the Communist Party and its adherents, why it became the main target of McCarthyism.
American Inquisition, Lecture 2, Communism in America, the World of the Witches.
In this lecture, we're going to be looking at the American Communist Party. As we noticed in our last lecture, most of the quote-unquote victims of the McCarthy era were not innocent liberals, but people who were in or near the Communist Party. As a result, we need to know something about these people's political background. And in this lecture, we're going to be looking at the history of American communism. We're going to be looking at why people joined the party, what they did while they were in it, and in particular, what it was about the American Communist Party that made it so vulnerable to the political repression directed against it. I realize that this may be a somewhat controversial issue here. Communism and anti-communism often elicit a lot of opposition, a lot of emotion. But we're historians, and so we're going to be trying to look at the party, not judge it, but look at it as a historical phenomenon. Where did it come from, and what did it do? Let's begin by looking at its origins. It began, actually, as the left wing of the American Socialist Party, a fairly broad party that encompassed a number of radical and somewhat less radical individuals. And it developed in a moment that seemed for many people to be the moment of a revolution, a worldwide revolution that followed World War I and the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia in 1917. American socialists who had not really been particularly powerful or popular in this country saw their fellows over there in Moscow and St. Petersburg taking over an entire country. And many of them thought this was just, you know, the greatest thing since sliced bread. And they split off from the sort of more conservative wing of the American Socialist Party and followed communism, developed their own party, one that they saw as the American branch of the Russian Revolution. And at least within the radical circles in the United States, this Soviet connection gave them a lot of prestige. After all, they had the franchise for the only successful revolution, the only successful socialist revolution in world history. Hey, they're part of history. Now, in its early days, the American Communist Party was not very big, not very powerful, and not very American. In fact, most of its members were immigrants, foreign-born people from Lithuania, from Finland, Poland. People, many communist newspapers were actually printed in foreign languages, not in English. And this was not a group that had a lot of power within the United States or a lot of attraction to ordinary Americans. In addition, it was a group that was illegal. the American government cracked down on it, was prosecuting members, radicals certainly, for all kinds of things. And we'll be looking at some of that prosecution during what has come to be known as the First Red Scare in our next set of lectures. But from the point of view of the sort of small sectarian American Communist Party, it's important to sort of get a sense of what it must have felt like to have been a very radical group talking revolution all the time and being arrested whenever they got together. So the party responded by going underground, by adopting fake names, by meeting in sort of clandestine ways. And this, it turned out, had a very deleterious long-term effect because it made the party sort of always have this kind of conspiratorial culture, a kind of slightly romanticized notion of danger of operating underground. Well, this is the United States, and this kind of a underground secret revolutionary party, although probably necessary in Tsarist Russia, was not really adapted to American political customs, and it always made American communism be a little bit beyond the pale, a little bit too exotic, a little bit unsuited for American political life. Another characteristic of this early communist party was the fact that it was absolutely riddled with schisms, with infighting, with all kinds of sort of petty arguments about this doctrinal point or that doctrinal point. And often sort of individual leaders would create their own little subgroups, often with really strange names like the geese. I don't know what the geese believed in, but that was one of the factions. And as a result, during the early years of American communism in the 1920s, you had a small, largely foreign, little group of, what would we call them, debaters? They were more than debaters. They were just arguing all the time. How did they settle their arguments? They went to Moscow. And one of the most important characteristics of American communism, of course, is its connection to the Soviet Union, its connection to what came to be known as the Comintern, which was a sort of international controlling body of all the communist parties in the world. And this was, ironically, both a source of strength for the American Communist Party, but also, and ultimately, probably its most serious disadvantage. In the early days, however, the Soviet connection helped the American Party solve its conflicts. The feuding parties would go to Moscow, and the authorities in Russia would simply select who they wanted to be the leader. The Soviet authorities also handed down the supposed political line. This, unfortunately, usually represented Soviet priorities rather than American ones, and it could often be rather disastrous, as we're going to see, in the sense that these Soviet directives made the American Party rather distant from American issues. Not all the time. For example, Stalin thought of himself as a great theorist of nationalities, and he decided that American blacks were a separate nationality, and he forced the American Party in the late 20s and early 30s to begin to confront the issue of racial segregation. It probably would have done it anyhow, but that initial directive came from Moscow. Many other directives that came from Moscow, however, were much more deleterious and ultimately destroyed the party in many ways. The party also, at least in its early period, got money from Russia, which helped it. It helped it in a number of ways. One, it enabled it to publish magazines and newspapers. It also enabled it to allow many of its members to work full-time on political issues. And this was another very important characteristic of American communism. Its discipline characteristic, the fact that communists followed orders, that communists obeyed the line. Now, we tend to view this in a very negative way. You know, these people aren't really individuals, they're robots. And they were portrayed during the McCarthy period often as sort of puppets. You know, there's Stalin sitting in the Kremlin pulling the strings, and American party members were dancing to his tune. But in fact, politically, this was very useful because it maintained unity within the party. It kept the party focused. And many people joined the party specifically because of this discipline, because it made American communism much more politically effective than many other left-wing groups, which were looser, which weren't as focused, which didn't have the organizational strength of the party. This discipline was obviously very deleterious in the sense that it enabled many American communists to sort of smother their doubts about what was going on in Russia. They did have some information, not a lot of information about the purges, but they tended to repress it. They tended to sort of shove it under the rug. You know, we can't have a revolution without breaking eggs. You can't have an omelet without breaking eggs. Stalin knows best. He's fighting Nazism. So let's not really look at what's going on in Russia. Later on, many of these people realized they'd made a very serious mistake. But at the time, they kind of prided themselves on being good communists, on being good party people who were following the appropriate line. Another aspect of American communism was the fact that it did develop a core of what were known as cadres, people who worked full-time as political organizers, both in the party, but also in an array of what were called front groups. And this is another very important aspect of American communism that I think we need to look at. During its heyday in the 1930s, the American Communist Party was at the organizational center of a whole constellation of causes, of organizations that ranged from the labor movement to literary magazines to organized benevolent societies. There was one group called the International Workers' Order, for example, that sold insurance and cemetery plots to left-wingers. There were communist summer camps. There were communist baseball teams. There were communist literary magazines. There were communist dance groups. There were also communist peace groups, communist civil liberties groups, and a wide range of sort of political, social, cultural organizations that people who were concerned with issues of social justice, of peace, even folk music, could get involved with. And what's important about these front groups was, of course, that during the McCarthy era, these were the areas where the witch hunters went hunting. Because one of the other problems with the Communist Party was that as a result of its early beginnings during the post-World War I.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.